Leadership begins within first. Let me explain something to you about this truth. We got to be doing the, before you become a captain of whatever officer, you should be doing the work before you are given the title. You mean understand that? You want to be raised up, but you are not doing the work of a captain. I want to be a captain. You're not doing the work of a captain. We got to beg you over and over. A leader sees a problem, and what does he do? He takes the initiative. He fixes it. I see a problem here. Something lacking. I'm going to fix it. The Bible is the solution for black leadership, black and Latin leadership, the Israelites. The Bible teaches us all things. Watch this. Give me Hosea 4 and 6. I'm going to cover two different, I'm going to try and segue from one thing to another, but I'm going to cover two things. Hosea chapter 4 and verse 6. Let's start there.
The book of Hosea chapter 4 verse 6. My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge.
The Bible says my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. God's people are the Israelites, the blacks and Latinos. From there, hold that. Hold that, Officer Liam. Go to Isaiah 5:13, please.
Isaiah chapter 5, verse 13. Therefore, my people are gone into captivity because they have no knowledge.
So it says my people have gone into captivity because they have no knowledge. Give me that one, the precept for knowledge in Malachi now 2 and 7. So in Hosea it says my people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge. Now in Isaiah it says we've gone into captivity because we have no knowledge. Okay?
The book of Malachi, chapter 2, verse 7. For the priest's lips should keep knowledge, and they should seek the law at his mouth.
So God's knowledge is his laws. So now when we backtrack, go back to Isaiah 5:13 now. We're going to backtrack. Isaiah 5:13.
My people are gone into captivity.
Meaning my people have gone into captivity because we have no knowledge of God's laws. That's what he's saying. Was that the whole verse?
No, sir. Therefore, my people are gone into captivity because they have no knowledge, and their honorable men are famished.
Meaning the leaders of our people are famished. Famished from what? God's knowledge. Famished from his laws. Go ahead.
And their multitude dried up with thirst.
We're dried up with thirst. Thirst for what? God's laws, God's knowledge. Now backtrack to Hosea 4, 6. Now we have the thought. That's how precept upon precept works. Go ahead.
Hosea 4, verse 6. My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge.
My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. What is the knowledge? God's laws. We are destroyed as a race, as a nation, because we don't know God's laws. Read.
Because thou hast rejected knowledge.
And because our people, our race, has rejected God's laws. That's what it's saying. Go ahead.
I will also reject thee.
I will also reject thee. That's us going into captivity. That's what it means. When God rejected us, we went into slavery. Read.
That thou shalt be no priest to me.
Now you see that part, that thou shalt be no priest to me. A lot of people don't understand what that means. Give me the precept in Exodus. This is the prophecy, the promise of what we are to be to God. Because you sit there and read that and go, we're no priest to God. So? Exodus 19:6. Here's the promise.
The book of Exodus, chapter 19, verse 6. And ye shall be unto me a kingdom of priests.
Now, this wasn't during the time of Moses. This is prophetic for the return of Christ. Read that again.
And ye shall be unto me a kingdom of priests and an holy nation.
We shall be a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. That is prophetic, not during the time when Moses spoke that, but for the second return of Christ. Now give me the precept for that. Revelate, was that the old verse?
No, sir.
Go ahead.
These are the words which thou shalt speak unto the children of Israel.
So it's prophesied that all of us would be a kingdom of priests. Now, precept, Revelation 1:6, please. showing you that Exodus 19 and 6 was prophetic, is prophetic for the second coming of Christ.
Revelation chapter 1, verse 6. And hath made us kings and priests unto God.
And hath made us kings and priests unto God. Was that the whole verse?
And his Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen.
Amen. Now go back to where you was at in Hosea. Now we've touched on various precepts. This is how you read the Bible. This is how you get the understanding of the Bible. You can't just read it like a novel. You can read it like a novel if you want, but you just get a basic understanding, but you're not going to get the mysteries of the Bible.
Hosea 4 and 6, My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge.
Meaning my people are destroyed for lack of knowing God's laws, right?
Because thou hast rejected knowledge.
And because we as a people have rejected God's laws, go ahead.
I will also reject thee.
He will also reject us. That's why we went into slavery. Read.
That thou shalt be no priest to me.
Meaning what? You will not be a priest in the coming kingdom. You will not be in the coming kingdom. That's what he's saying right there. Go ahead.
Seeing thou hast forgotten the law of thy God.
See that? See, and he's explaining, because you have forgotten the law of your God. So Christianity, that abominable religion, has taught us to forget God's laws. Now there's an onslaught to fight against the Israelites from raising up the 12 tribes, but they shall lose. They shall lose. Was that it?
I will also forget thy children.
Yes, that goes right back to the prophet promise that we would not be priests in the coming kingdom. Give me Revelation 7, 4. So Christ said we would be a nation of kings and priests. Let's see who that's talking about. Revelation 7, 4.
Revelation chapter 7, verse 4. And I heard the number of them which were sealed. And there were sealed 144,000 of all the tribes of the children of Israel.
So the 144,000, the 144K, that's the leading body of the nation of Israel. Those are the leading men of the nation of Israel. Read the verse again.
And I heard the number of them which were sealed. And there were sealed 144,000 of all the tribes of the children of Israel.
So that's what we're about. Raising up the 12 tribes of the nation of Israel. And the men must be built up. And what I've seen and noticed going from cities to states is that there's one problem with brothers being put up in positions of leadership. The word leader, look up the word leader, please. Can y'all look up that word for me? Or lead. Look up leader. Leadership. Look up leadership. Because the 144,000 are 12,000 of all the tribes of Israel. Those are the leaders. I want y'all to understand. So see that leadership. Noun, the action of leading a group of people or an organization. The state or position of being a leader. The leaders of an organization, etc. Click some more. Okay, give me leader, leader. Now, y'all see all the meanings, right? The definitions. You got pioneer, front runner, chief, head, principal. Let me ask y'all a question. You see it says, go back. I want to show you something. You see where it says noun, N-O-U-N? A noun is the name of a person, place, or thing. Is that right? What is a verb? Verb is an action word. So when the Bible talks about Israel, the 144 being leaders, do you think God means it in context of a noun or a verb? A verb. Being a leader is not, some of you and some of you online want to be a leader as a noun. What do I mean by that? Meaning a name only. I want to be a soldier. I want to be officer of 10. I want to be officer of 500, captain of 500. I want to be whatever the hell it is. Officer of 50, 40, 60, captain of 100, captain of 200. And as a noun, brother, meaning in name only. I don't want the verb of that. I don't want the verb because that means I got to get off my fat behind and do something. I don't want that.
Responsibility goes yes. with that thing. I don't want that.
I don't want that. I just respect my rank. As a noun, but not as a verb. So now, watch this. To a Negro Latino, the word leader is a noun, name only. To an Israelite, that's good. difference between a Negro, a Latino, and an Israelite. To an Israelite, leadership should be a verb. Is that right, brothers? Okay. Okay. The word steward. Can we look that word up? Steward. Steward. The position and duties of a steward, a person who acts as the surrogate of another or others, especially by managing property, financial affairs, and estate. The responsible overseeing and protection of something considered worth caring for and preserving. Watch what the Bible says. Give me that 1 Corinthians 4, verse 1 and 2.
1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 1. Let a man so account of us as of the ministers of Christ and stewards of the mysteries of God.
So the Apostle Peter said he himself is a steward of the mysteries of God. Because some of you right now probably figured, oh, a steward, that must just mean the soldiers in here. No, we're all stewards. The position and duties of a steward, a person who acts as the surrogate of another. I like number two. The responsible overseeing and protection of something considered worth caring for and preserving. We are all stewards. The Apostle Peter, who was the top apostle, was a steward. Read that again. Chapter 4, verse 1.
Let a man so account of us.
The us is Peter and them. Paul, Go ahead.
As of the ministers of Christ.
Go ahead.
And stewards.
And notice it says of the ministers of Christ and stewards of the mysteries of God. We are stewards of the mysteries of God. Not as a noun, as a verb. There's a difference. There's a difference. Some of you just want to be titles only, names only. Read on.
Moreover, it is required in stewards that a man be found faithful.
We must be found faithful in this truth. Watch this. Give me Romans 12, 1 and 2.
Romans 12 and 1. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice.
So in this truth, we are all a living sacrifice. Come on.
Holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service.
Which is your reasonable service. Your reason. See that word service? Service is a verb. It's an action word, not a noun. Not in title, not in name. It's a verb, action. That's our reasonable service. Go ahead.
And be not conformed to this world.
Be not conformed to this world. This world today is the United States of America. That's what this world is talking about. During the time of Paul who wrote this, he was making reference to Rome. Because Israel was following the Roman customs, Greco-Roman customs. Now today it is the United States of America. World superpower. The Bible says do not be conformed to this world. This world says same-sex marriage is okay. You want to be conformed to this world, you will accept that. This world says it is okay for the black woman to kill over 16 million babies, abort them in a year. This world says it's okay. We must not be conformed to this world. This world says a man should not have a badge of dignity, which is his facial hair that God gave us. This world says, shave it off. This world says, do not stand up for what that Bible says. Don't be conformed to this world. This world says a marriage is 50-50. The Bible says a man is head of the house. Be not conformed to this world. This world says women can dress as men, men can dress as women. Be not conformed to this world. Read.
But be transformed by the renewing of your mind.
Only the Bible can renew your mind. Change your thinking. Only the Bible can do it. That's why God says your thoughts are not my thoughts. Why? Because our thoughts, every last one of us in here, our thoughts is television. Our thoughts is the media. Our thoughts, you see people crying about, I'm going to show you how our people's thoughts is the media. Our people upset because Hillary Clinton lost the presidential garbage. They mad. I must have looked at 15 videos yesterday that black people said she lost because black people did not go out and vote. I'm like, wait a minute. Wait, stop. 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 Hillary Clinton won over 1 million. She got 1 million more of the popular vote than Donald Trump. But still enough black people didn't go out and vote. He didn't win. You don't win an election based on a popular vote. You win based on the Electoral College. We've been telling people that for years. Black man, black woman, your count, your vote is garbage. It's just to keep you occupied, give you something to do, make you think you're important. We have told y'all that this man stole this country, raped, robbed, murdered, enslaved us as well. You think he's going to take a chance and let a Negro who's not for his benefit up in the White House? He's not going to do it. Anyone that goes in the White House is going to be a puppet. Is going to be manipulated. We told you about that, Barack Obama. Yeah, we love the brother, but still, he's a puppet. Go back. Read it again.
And be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God.
Y'all see that word, prove? That ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. In order for you to prove it, it's not just in words alone. It's in what? Actions. Actions. That's how you prove the Bible is real, in your actions. Not just, I'm an Israelite. Yes, I'm an Israelite. But then you celebrate Christmas. You celebrate Kwanzaa, New Year's Eve. You don't take care of your kids, your family. You got images of white folks all on your walls at home. You got the white image of Jesus on your wall. Yes, I'm an Israelite. No, stop. In order to prove it, you must prove it through actions. That means everything changes. The way you dress will change. Your thoughts will change. The holidays you celebrate will change. The way you deal with your wife and family will change. Everything about you will change, and people will watch you and observe you. I'm going to check him out, see if he's right, see if he's real. He might be whistling Dixie. Give me Matthew 23:11. Everybody want to be in a leadership position, but nobody want to work. Nobody want to do the actions. I want to be the grand poobah. Okay, brother, you're the grand poobah. I want to be a captain of 1 million. Okay, brother, you're captain of 1 million. Yeah, yeah. Read that for me.
Matthew 23:11.
And you know what makes me laugh? Why do you have a captain of 10,000, but you only got 20 people in the camp? That never made sense to me. It never will make sense. That's somebody blowing smoke somewhere. Read that.
Matthew 23:11. But he that is greatest among you shall be your servant.
Read it again.
But he that is greatest among you shall be your servant.
Nobody wants to obey that. Everybody want rank and position so they could go, shut up, sit down, go over here, do this, do that. But nobody wants to serve. Nobody wants to go and be a servant. I've seen it in New York. I've seen it in Boston. I've seen it in Jamaica. I've seen it in the UK. I've seen it in Texas. I've seen it in Florida. I see it all over the place. Read it again.
But he that is greatest among you shall be your servant.
Nobody wants to be a servant. Nobody wants, because to be a servant, that goes back to stewardship, that goes back to leadership. Nobody wants to do that. Give me 1 Samuel 2:3, please.
1 Samuel 2:3. Talk no more so exceeding proudly.
Talk no more exceeding proudly. Come on.
Let not arrogancy come out of your mouth.
Let not arrogancy come out of your mouth.
For the Lord is a God of knowledge.
For the Lord is a God of knowledge. Go ahead.
And by him, actions are weighed.
Actions are weighed. The Most High will judge us based on our knowledge and our actions with the knowledge we got. That's how we're going to be judged. You got knowledge, but you won't do a damn thing. Oh, you're going to get judged, all right. Read it again.
Talk no more, so exceeding proudly. Let not arrogancy come out of your mouth, for the Lord is a God of knowledge, and by him actions are weighed.
By him actions are weighed. Actions are weighed. Actions are weighed. Everybody want to be in a position of authority, but nobody want to do the work. I've witnessed and watched black men talk about racial disparity with the police. I watched an interview with Eric, what's his name, Dyson, and Giuliani. Now, of course, we're no fans of Giuliani. But while Eric, am I saying the brother's Eric Dyson, right? While he was blasting Giuliani with his attack of 13-syllable words about police brutality, Giuliani made a statement. He said, all right, why don't we pull the police back out of the black community and let you black men police yourselves? Then you could hear crickets. You heard crickets, and Eric Dyson just started to, see, that's what I'm talking about. See, see? Then all the big words went out the air, out the way. Actions. We talk about we hate police brutality. Now, I'll get a million examples. We don't like police. We hate the police. Okay, here I am, Flatbush, Brooklyn, little girl gets raped, 5 years old. I'll put wanted posters all around. Who knows who raped the five-year-old girl? Put the posters everywhere. Here comes the Negroes ripping down the posters. We don't snitch. The Negro is a phenomenon. The Negro is was created by a Frankenstein monster. What is wrong with our people? We don't snitch, brother. So what you going to do about the little girl that got raped? Nothing.
Five-year-old girl gets raped. And a Negro thought that was okay. You see, that's the reason why the Lord created that bomb.
That they got to go.
That thing has to be used.
They got to go. If the Bible cannot transform us, our people must die. Give me that precept. I forgot. It's Isaiah 26. Somebody, this iniquity shall not pass from you. That one. 22:14. Thank you. When you tell a black man and a Latin man, stand up, police your community, take care of your community, the lip falls out and drags the floor like Bubba. You know that goon on Fat Albert?
Mush Mouth.
Mush Mouth.
That was his name.
That's us. That's our people. Come on, read that.
Isaiah 22, verse 14. And it was revealed in mine ears by the Lord of hosts. Surely this iniquity shall not be purged from you till ye die.
Some iniquity won't be purged from our people till they die. They must die. That's why Zechariah says two-thirds must die. And you just hate black people. No, we love black people. We love Israelites. Let me put it that way. Black people are generally Negroes with their bottom lip hanging.
Moses, you remember when Moses put him in the pool? Their old law have to come back strong in the black community. To purify their community, these, like you mentioned, the guy who pulled the poster down, soon he put one down, bang! You understand? That their old law have to come back, man. That's why we pray in the Lord through Christ bring the old law back. Any ignorance, Negroes in our kingdom going to be put to death.
Mm-hmm, exactly. There was a police officer in Detroit, black brother. Some of y'all might have saw him on I did a radio show with him. Anyway, he wanted to change, fix the community. As it turned out, what he started to do was rob drug dealers and then sell the drugs back to their rivals. In Rikers Island, correction officers, not all of them, but some of them, black and Latino, you always ask yourself, how did they get drugs inside Rikers? You better believe some of the COs is allowing that thing to go down. Black people. We're not talking about white folks. We want to talk about white man is the devil till we blue in the face. But the things I'm mentioning, I'm talking about our people. No, we don't want to talk about that. We just want to talk about white people. No, we have to, the change begins within first.
That's the message.
That's what it does.
We never want to face that, Bishop. We always want to put the blame externally. We never want to start like that record that Michael Jackson, I don't like to refer to him, but he made a record called The Man in the Mirror. That's how you have to start with that person first, you.
And don't get it twisted. We are very, very aware that the white man creates an environment. He engineers a society to commit criminal activity. He engineers that. We understand that. But when you get this Bible, you're able to open your eyes and see the traps out there. Like, give me that scripture about Solomon when he says, give me no... You know what I'm talking about? Proverbs 30. Give me the verse. about riches and poverty. I'm going to show you what the white man did. I'm going to talk about the white man just for a second, just to appease you, just for a second. Then I'm going to go back to you.
Proverbs chapter 30, verse 7.
Proverbs chapter 30 and verse 7.
Two things have I required of thee. Uh-huh. Deny me them not before I die.
Uh-huh.
Remove far from me vanity and lies. Give me neither poverty nor riches. Feed me with food convenient for me.
Now he's going to explain. Go ahead.
Lest I be full and deny thee.
He said, if I'm too full, I got too much money, I will deny you. Hence, your entertainment community. A lot of them don't even want to acknowledge the Most High God. The entertainment community is today your modern house Negroes. Why? Because they're full. Living in mansions in 6 and 7 cars. They're full. Some of them got their own planes. They're full. Read that again.
Lest I be full and deny thee and say, who is the Lord?
Who is the Lord? I don't accept that Bible. Go ahead.
Or lest I be poor.
Here comes lest I be poor.
And steal. And take the name of my God in vain.
You don't think the white man understood that basic understanding there? That if you are full, you will deny the Lord. And if you are poor, you will steal. Hence, it's not by accident poverty covers the black and Latin community. It's by design. It's designed that way. Hence, we go, and then, yes, we know they put drugs and weapons in our communities. We aware of that. And we do know that they allow blacks and Latinos to go down I-95 and purchase weapons and bring it back down I-95. We aware of that. The white man sees this stuff. He sees it and is well aware of it. But the Bible is meant to open our eyes so that we can see the traps. We are the last hired but first fired, not by accident but by design. Crack, heroin, cocaine, methamphetamine, all these various things are in our communities, not by accident but by design. So that what? It keeps crime going. Hence, the police have a job. Correction officers have a job. The judge got a job. The district attorney got a job. Lawyers got a job. Fire department got a job. Everybody got a job but you. Not by accident, but by design. So, what are we going to do about this stuff? The Bible is the big changer. Give me Job 32. So again, we come into this truth. Everybody says, I want to be a soldier. I want to. You don't have to be a soldier. You could be a member to Christ. You just be a member. That means there's no responsibility for you. Just come in, learn the scriptures, go home. Once you become a soldier, you're putting your hand to the plow and say, I want to do this work. I want to help organize the people. That's what you're saying when you say, I want to become a soldier. From soldier, then you got officer of what? Officer of 10. 10. 20. 50. Captain of 100, 200, officer of 80, 60, 70, 80, captain of 100, 200, 300, 400, 500, blah, blah, blah. Why you want to go up to 500? I'm keeping our numbers right around there for a purpose. We could go to a couple of thousand, but no. So some of you come in this truth. You see the problems. You hear the Bible as the solution. But you want a title. You want to be a leader, but in title only. Give me that, Job 32 and 21.
The book of Job, chapter 32, verse 21. Let me not, I pray you, accept any man's person, neither let me give flattering titles unto man.
Neither let me give flattering titles unto men. I want to be a captain of 10,000, but brother, you only got 20 people in the school. How are you a captain of 10,000? I want the title. I want to be the grand poobah.
Not only that, you want to be a captain of 1,000, and they got 20 brothers there, and they all out of order.
Exactly. Exactly. Read on.
For I know not to give flattering titles.
For I know not to give flattering titles. Flattering titles leads into partiality. That's what the whole two verses talk about. Go ahead.
In so doing, my maker would soon take me away.
Right. When you give flattering titles unto men, you tend to be partial to them. And it says, my maker will soon take me away. So to be have a position or rank of authority in title only, meaning a noun, the Lord will do away with you. I want to be this. I want to be that. But what are you? Let me explain something to you about this truth. We got to be doing the, before you become a captain of whatever officer, you should be doing the work before you are given the title. You mean understand that? You want to be raised up, but you are not doing the work of a captain. I want to be a captain. You're not doing the work of a captain. We got to beg you over and over. Brother, can you do this for us? Brother, can you do that? Can you do this? A leader sees a problem, and what does he do? He takes the initiative. He fixes it. I see a problem here. Something lacking. I'm going to fix it. That's why I give me that in Titus 1 and 5. Some black people don't understand that. I just want a title. Just give me a title. To hell with the titles. Titus 1 and 5, I think that's it.
Titus chapter 1 and verse 5. For this cause left I thee in Crete, that thou shouldest set in order the things that are wanting.
See that, set in order. When you set something in order, that's an action. That's not a noun. Those are verbs. Set in order the things that are lacking. That's what leaders do. That's what we do. Set things in order. There's a problem, address it. What is the solution to this problem here? What does the Bible say on this subject? Let's fix it. That's what leadership does. That's what you men are coming in. That's what the 144,000 will do. And if we are going to be a part of that, we must do these things in actions, not in nouns. Just talk about it. Just talk about it. From there, give me Sirach 37. The first thing when you come into this truth, when you want to fix anything, the first thing you must fix is, guess what, brothers? You tell me. Yourself. Yourself. It starts within first. Give me that. Sirach 37, 19.
Sirach, chapter 37, verse 19. There is one that is wise and teacheth many.
There is one that is wise and he teaches many. He go through the scriptures good. Go ahead.
And yet is unprofitable to himself.
He never applies what he has been studying to himself, to his own life. Leadership begins with you first, within. Let me discipline the lust within me. Let me discipline my thoughts. Let me discipline my tongue. Give me that scripture in James about the mouth. You know what I want? James 3. About the tongue is a world of iniquity, setting the course of nature on fire. That one. Find that for me. Discipline begins within first. That's why in Christ addressed that. Christ said, don't look at your brother with a, who got a mote in his eye and you got a big beam in yours. Leadership begins within first. Come on. You got it?
James chapter 3, verse 5. Even so, the tongue is a little member and boasteth great things.
The tongue is a small member in your body, but it boasts great things. Go ahead.
Behold, how great a matter a little fire kindleth. Uh-huh. And the tongue is a fire. A world of iniquity. So is the tongue among our members, that it defileth the whole body.
See that? Your tongue can defile your whole body, saying things it ought not to say. Go ahead.
And setteth on fire the course of nature.
Here's an example. Here's an remember the white woman in Rosewood having sex with the white man. She was committing adultery, and she said, a Negro raped me. Rosewood was burned to the ground because of that woman's tongue. Setting on fire. Read that verse again.
And the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. So is the tongue among our members, that it defileth the whole body, and setteth on fire the course of nature, and is set on fire of hell.
And then you had Esther Rose's character. I forgot her character in the movie. She, yeah, Florida Evans. But that wasn't her name in Rosewood. She refused to say. She knew the white man was banging a white woman. She didn't want to say nothing. She kept quiet to the very end because she wanted to save Massa. I don't want nothing to have Miss Anne. Meanwhile, her own. That's the part that infuriated me about the movie. All her people getting put to death because of her. She don't want to say nothing. I'm not going to say nothing. People get dead. She got put to death. So, go back. To Sirach 37:19. So the tongue is a small matter. So discipline begins with disciplining the things you say, your thoughts. disciplining the lust within you, your actions, the things you do.
Ecclesiasticus chapter 37, verse 19.
Right, thank you. Black Wall Street got burnt up for that same situation. Same kind of thing. Even when Emmett Till did that, they say he whistled. They say he did. Put the death up behind that. Where we at?
Verse 19. There is one that is wise and teacheth many, and yet is unprofitable to himself.
And yet is unprofitable to himself. That's the one that has a leadership as a noun. Now watch this, 1 Timothy 3:5. After you begin to discipline yourself, now in this truth, you brothers, listen good. You discipline yourself. You're getting your tongue in order, your thoughts in order, your actions in order. Hey, guess what? You're getting your eyes in order. What do you mean your eyes in order? Give me that. It's in Job. You know what I want? Job, my eye. I made a covenant with my eyes. Give me that. 31? 31 and 1. Let me look at it.
Job 31, verse 1. I made a covenant with mine eyes.
You see that? Job says, I made a covenant with mine eyes. You're going to, what do you mean by that, Reed?
Why then should I think upon a maid?
Because if you don't discipline your thoughts about women, your eyes will start to lead you that on that side of the room. And you won't be looking at them in their eyes. You'll be looking below their neck. On their backside when they're walking past you. Job said, I made a covenant with my eyes. Go ahead.
Why then should I think upon a maid?
Why then should I think upon a maid? Watch this. Jump down to verse 9. Get to the point.
Verse 9. If mine heart have been deceived by a woman.
If my mind have been deceived by a woman.
Or if I have laid wait at my neighbor's door.
If I laid wait at my neighbor's door. Then meaning what? He wants to have sex with his neighbor's wife. That's the thought. Watch what he says.
Then let my wife grind unto another.
Then let my wife grind. You know what they mean by grind, brothers? He ain't talking about no dancing. Right. Grind unto another. Go ahead.
And let others bow down upon her.
And let others bang her out. That's what Job said. So he said, so that won't happen. I make a covenant with my eyes. I got my eyes in check. I got my thoughts in check. That's what a leader does first. But with black people, it's always the last thing. From there, give me 1 Timothy 3:5.
Bishop.
Yes.
Even though in Friday, that's what I, same thing you saying. Yeah, because a lot of time this world is to define us, define who we want to be in this truth. Then they call it so-called either culture or customs that we have learned when we was young. You understand? Because that's what when we was young talking about, big breasts, big booty. Then you come in this truth, you want to let their conversation go. Because their conversations and the eyes and the thought going to manifest in the body. You understand? That a lot of brothers don't understand. If you into watching BTM TV.
And porn.
Yeah, and porn. It's going to manifest in the body. Like the bishop just said. Now your eyes is over here instead of focus. You understand? Because their thoughts still there. You understand? We have to be very, very mindful. The thing that we watch is going to affect us down the line. As a leader, we cannot afford that. So that's why we have to be very, very mindful what we watch, who we talk to, what's going on within our mind.
Exactly. Read that. 1 Timothy 3:5.
1 Timothy 3, verse 5. For if a man know not how to rule his own house.
So after you just begin to discipline yourself, you brothers, some of you come in married, some of you not. You want to get a wife. Okay, you get a wife. Here's the next stipulation for leadership. Go ahead.
For if a man know not how to rule his own house.
If a man know not how to. See that word? See that word rule? Guess what, brothers? It's a verb. It's not a noun. Rule is an action. Not a noun. Read it again.
For if a man know not how to rule his own house, how shall he take care of the church of God?
How shall he take care of the church of God? The Bible said if you can't rule your house, and that's today's society, examine black men today. Examine us. Just examine real good. The women already know. Women ain't got to do too much examination. A lot of them be on a Monday morning line at court to get child support. Yes, society has bred black men to be immature men. Society has bred us that way. But it was up to the older men to set the younger men in order, what to do, what not to, but that wasn't done. So the older men didn't do what they were commanded to do, Give me that so y'all know what I'm talking about. Titus 2, about the old men, older men. I'm looking at, what's that Tyler Perry movie with Cicely Tyson? What's the name of it?
Family Reunion.
Family Reunion. There's a scene where the older brothers at the family reunion, they're all sitting around drinking, and a young girl at the family reunion walks by, and one of them go, who that girl right there? Look at that thing right there. Who that girl? They said, that's your cousin right there. Cousin such and such. I was looking, I said, what the hell is this? But when I saw it, the reason I related to it, because when I used to go to my family reunions, same thing. That's exactly how they talk. All the girls was half, my cousins half naked, walk. So when I saw the movie, I said, I related to it. I said, this is my family right there. All the girls half naked, all the older men, 50, 60, girls, ha ha, look at that girl right there. Come on, come on, come on. Hey, girl, there's a dollar on the floor. Pick it up, get that dollar right there. They're waiting for the girl to bend over and pick it up. That's in the movie, and I used to see that stuff. Watch this, Titus 2.
Titus chapter 2, verse 2. That the aged man be sober.
That the aged man be sober. Not drunk, not high. Go ahead.
Grave.
The word grave means serious. That the aged man be serious. Go ahead.
Temperate.
Temperate.
Sound in faith.
Sound in faith.
In charity and patience.
Come on.
The aged woman likewise.
Jump down to the young wisdom. Verse 6. Okay.
Verse 6. Young men likewise exhort to be sober-minded.
You see that word likewise? Young men likewise, meaning in the same way as the older ones.
Exhort to be sober-minded in all things, showing thyself a pattern of good works.
Because the younger men were supposed to follow the pattern of good works from the aged men. That's the cycle of what God set up for us. But as a people, as a race, as a nation, we have not obeyed the gospel. We have not obeyed those basic Bible principles. So young men run the streets with their pants below their butt. And you know what amazes me about that? When I see 40-year-old, 50-year-old, 60-year-old men with their pants below their butt and bobo braids in there, I'm looking at older brothers following the example of young knuckleheads, pants below their butt, bobo braids. It's crazy. I said, this is, our people is out of order. But when you tell them that, they lose their mind. No! Go back. 1 Timothy 3:5.
For if a man know not how to rule his own house, how shall he take care of the church of God?
Give me Acts 7 about the church. About the church. It might be Acts 7. When Stephen was talking about the church that was in the wilderness. Thank you.
The book of Acts 7:38. This is he that was in the church in the wilderness.
The church in the wilderness, brothers and sisters, was not, listen good to what I'm about to say, was not the Baptist church, was not the Pentecostal church. The church that was in the wilderness was the nation of Israel. That was the church. The church was not just Israel united in Christ. The church is making reference to the nation of Israel. Read it again for us.
This is he that was in the church in the wilderness with the angel which spake to him in the Mount Sinai.
So the church in the wilderness was the nation of Israel. So when we go back now to 1 Timothy 3:5 again. Was it 5?
Yeah. Verse 5.
Now we got a better thought in our head.
For if a man know not how to rule his own house.
Meaning your wife and kids. If you can't deal with that small matter, go ahead.
How shall he take care of the church of God?
How can you take care of the nation of Israel? How can you do it? Christ is speaking through Paul. He said it's impossible. They are leaders only in title only, those brothers, like that. When you see a brother who's reckless in the congregation, you can tell that his wife is pretty much running the house. Because when he comes here, he does not know how to deal with other brothers. He don't know how to conduct himself properly. He's always out of order. You can fix it in your head to understand that at home, his wife takes care of everything. So when he comes amongst the brothers, the men, he don't know how to deal right. He's always angry. He's always misunderstanding. There's always a problem with him because he's not been a leader at home. So this is new to him. He's confused. I don't know what to do. I'm confused. Give me Baruch 4. Thank you. Baruch 4, 1 and 2. Baruch 4 in Apocrypha. So the Bible is the antidote to our sickness. The Bible is the solution for black leadership, black and Latin leadership, the Israelites. The Bible teaches us all things. Watch this.
Baruch 4, verse 1. This is the book of the commandments of God.
Some people think the Bible is a book of nice stories. That ain't what the Bible says. Read that part again.
This is the book of the commandments of God.
That's what the Bible is. A book of commandments of God. Not a book of nice stories. It's a book of the commandments of God. Go ahead.
And the law that endureth forever.
And it consists of the law that endureth forever. Go ahead.
All they that keep it shall come to life.
All they that keep the laws that's in this Bible shall come to life. That's why Romans 6:23 says the wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. The eternal life is the life that we're reading there in Baruch 4. Read that verse again.
This is the book of the commandments of God and the law that endureth forever. All they that keep it shall come to life, but such as leave it shall die.
But such as leave it shall die. That's what the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Read.
Turn thee, O Jacob.
Jacob is us. We're Jacob. Go ahead.
Turn thee, O Jacob, and take hold of it.
Take hold of the Bible, your records. Go ahead.
Walk in the presence of the light thereof.
Walk in the presence of the light. The Bible is a book of light, meaning laws. Go ahead.
That thou mayest be illuminated.
That thou mayest be illuminated. We are the Illuminati. We are the real illuminated ones. Understand that. Okay? I ain't not talking about no secret society garbage. The Bible says this book illuminates us. It illuminates, because right now we're in darkness. Mm-hmm. We don't know how to deal with a woman. We don't know how to raise our children. There's so many things we don't know how to do that the Bible explains in great detail.
Knowing how to raise your family is letting your light shine. The same stuff that what the bishop is bringing out, because this illumination here is talking about letting the laws of God shine through you. That's what it's talking about.
Exactly. Come on.
1 Timothy 3 and 5. For if a man know not how to rule his own house.
Y'all see that word rule? Some of you don't like that word, but guess what? Being born again means proper application of God's laws to your life. Women going to allow that man to rule. That's what the born again woman going to do. But the Negro, Babylonian, American mind woman, the European Negro woman, she ain't going to let that happen. You ain't ruling me. Now give me that Genesis. Here's where Paul got it from. Genesis 3:16. This is where he got it from. Now we ain't talking about abuse, because some women interpret the word rule to abuse, verbal and physical. Nobody in here is talking about verbal or physical abuse at all. So tell the devil to leave. Say, Satan, I rebuke you in the name of Jesus. Nobody's talking about verbal or physical abuse. Read that.
The book of Genesis, chapter 3, verse 16. Unto the woman, he said, I will greatly multiply thy sorrow and thy conception. And sorrow thou shalt bring forth children, and thy desire shall be to thy husband, and he shall rule over thee.
That's the law. That's God's law. So being born again, the man will now take his rightful position in the home. The woman will take her rightful position in the home. That's what being born again means. Because God told us in Isaiah 55, Officer Liam, get that for me, about our thoughts. So y'all know I didn't just make it up. Some of y'all want to get married up in here. I heard the three of y'all want to get married next month. Well, you brothers better make sure your wife understands God's laws. And you sisters, you better make sure, because some of you look around for that weak, mealy-mouthed, misunderstood brother. And so you look for him on purpose so you can rule him. I know what you do. Read that.
Isaiah 55, verse 8. For my thoughts are not your thoughts.
That's why we got to be born again, because our thoughts are not God's thoughts. Our thoughts is television. Our thoughts is white man media. So now in being born again, our whole train of thought must change and be put in its proper perspective. Was that the whole verse?
Neither are your ways my ways.
Neither your ways my ways. Because our ways is American society. That's what our ways are based upon. Everything we do is based upon white man society. Now we're trying to change. And we're going to have all type of opposition against it. Throw some water on Jonah's face. Give me Sirach chapter 8, verse 8 and 9.
Sirach chapter 8, verse 8. Despise not the discourse of the wise.
Despise not the discourse of the wise. You brothers coming in truth, some of you men up in here never had no daddy. You got brothers running around YouTube cursing us out, and these are the same. Listen, if you ain't over 30, sometimes I don't want to talk to you. Sometimes I don't want to talk to you because I know you're going to say something stupid. When I'm ready to talk to you, I'll talk to you. But I like to talk or be around brothers in my area because I'm going to hear something dumb. I'm going to get mad, especially if you're not approaching me as a young man. If you're approaching me like you're trying to be my equal, like you was back there with me when we was throwing drug dealers out the house. Remember that back then? If you wasn't there, don't try to say you was with me. No, no.
A lot of them weren't even itching their daddy's pants when we were doing that. So exactly. I don't need them telling me nothing. Just get the hell out of my face.
And this is what annoys me about what these daggone Iscariot twins. This annoyed the hell out of me. Little boys want to make themselves equal with grown-ups. This is the breakdown of society. You saw it in the world. You see it in Israel now. That's these little boys up in here. Read it for me again.
Sirach 8 and 8. Despise not the discourse of the wise.
When I was a kid, growing up, all of us young guys, we would sit around, not that the older men was wise, but they knew more than we did. We would sit there and listen to them. And then sometimes when it got into, when the conversation got too hot and heavy, hey, little man, get out of here. Get out of here. Or Papa said, phew. That's what they did. And we would sneak around the corner just to hear. We would watch how they dress. We watch everything they did. Then we came into the truth. We were 20. We watched the older men. We listened to their conversation. We sit there for hours. We don't say nothing. We just listen like this. Until one of them, the shy, would say, all right, little man, get out of here. Go to the store and get me something to drink. All right, you shy. Yeah, it's about to get heavy. We knew that. That's how we did. And that was from the era we came from. But not today's Negro, young Negro boy. He want to be, I know, Jason, not to you. Right. He is still living with his mama.
Right. These Negroes today have been incubated in a television. That's what the problem is. Their mind ain't right.
Read that again.
Despise not the discourse of the wise.
Uh-huh.
But acquaint thyself with their proverbs.
Acquaint thyself with their proverbs. I'll give another example. Let's see, do I want to tell that example? Yeah. My uncle, I'm young down south. He say to me, call me Little Nate. Little Nate. Come here, Little Nate. Come with me. All right, uncle, we going down. Take me. You know, down south got them. We didn't have no street lights. There was a dirt road we follow. Then he knew a shortcut cut through the corn crop, cornfield, cut right through it. Take me to this lady's house. He said, I'm going to introduce you to this lady. See, this is a safe story. I know people are going to be something that ain't going to be nasty. He said, I'm going to introduce you to her daughter. So the lady says her daughter was gone. So he said, oh, man, I knew it would have been nasty. I knew what he wanted me to do, but it didn't go down that way. Anyway, he says to me, later we walking around, he said, let me tell you something about the women. Now, this goes back to what we're reading here. He says, when you meet a woman, 9 times out of 10, what you want to do is meet her mama. He said, because if you ever think about getting serious, if ever, 9 times out of 10, the woman will turn out just like her mama. So if her mama is 550 pounds, chances are she going to turn out just like that. So I would soak all this in. He said, now, when you meet the woman, meet her mama, if she's home cursing out her daddy, her husband, 9 times out of 10, she going to curse you out. She nice right now. But when you get together with her, she going to treat you the same way her mama treat her daddy. So these were things that I was taught as a youth, and I soaked it and absorbed it. So now we come in this truth. Read that one more again.
Despise not the discourse of the wise, but acquaint thyself with their proverbs.
So now you come in this truth. We're trying to show you young men things about leadership, family. Just listen to us. We know what we're saying. We have gone through many a fire and come out of many fires. And we're unscathed, and the smell of smoke is not on us. So just listen when we're talking to you. Read on.
For of them thou shalt learn instruction.
For of them thou shalt learn instruction. Go ahead.
And how to serve great men with ease.
And how to serve great men with ease. Read.
Miss not the discourse of the elders, for they are also learned of their fathers.
For they also learned of their fathers. Go ahead.
And of them thou shalt learn understanding.
And of them thou shalt learn understanding. Go ahead.
And to give answer as need requires.
And this is why we tell you, just for example, we tell you young men, when you go to work, don't hand out flyers on your job. Do not share nothing with people on your job. It might be a trap. You might get set up. Don't go out to happy hour after work. When a job has one of those get-together parties, if it's mandatory for you to go, don't drink nothing, meaning water. Just only drink. Don't drink no alcohol. It's a test to see how you conduct yourself. We can only warn you. Some of you listen. Some of you don't. Give me Revelation 3:18.
Yeah, Bishop, you know, yes. Some brothers say you don't need no leader. Their scriptures just tell you from them. They're going to teach you on the spirit of understanding, how to understand. So you need men that have been there before you to teach you spirit of understanding, according exactly. to the Lord laws.
Here you got a young man. He barely met a woman, ain't never had a woman except when he went to the damn strip club. He went to counsel somebody on marriage. Shut the hell up. Have you ever been married? Have you ever raised? No. Shut up. And here go the excuse. Well, what about Paul? You don't know what Paul did. The scripture told you about the Pharisees, the things they did, and Paul was involved in a lot of the things the Pharisees were guilty of. I'll leave that for another lesson. Revelation 3:18.
The book of Revelation 3, verse 18. I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire.
The gold tried in the fire is Christ. Specifically now today, Christ is in this Bible. This is the gold tried in the fire. Go ahead.
That thou mayest be rich.
That thou mayest be rich. Come on.
And white raiment. That thou mayest be clothed, and that the shame of thy nakedness do not appear.
So that your sin does not appear. Clothe yourself in white, meaning clothe yourself in these scriptures, so that your sin does not appear. Go ahead.
And anoint thine eyes with eye salve, that thou mayest see.
See that part? And anoint thy eyes with eye salve, that thou mayest see. The eye salve is going into the commandments. I'm going to show you that in a few minutes. The eye salve is really going into the commandments. When you anoint yourself with God's commandments, you will see things clearly. That's what happened in the movie Nat, Birth of a Nation with Nat Turner. He said when he sat around by himself reading the Bible, he began to see the Bible with new eyes. He started to see things that he was not allowed to read before. So likewise us. This is why the white man is against Israelites now. He says, no, they're giving these brothers and sisters new eyes. The white man wants us to always read the Bible through their leprosy eyes. Their eyes with lack of melanin. That's what they want. So we see the Bible through their eyes. Oh, Jesus white. Moses white. Everybody's white. I ain't nothing but a dumb nigga. I ain't nobody. 50-50. I deserve what I get. Dang. I suck again. He wants us to read the Bible like that. The Lord says, no, you read that bottom precept again. Anoint thine eyes.
And anoint thine eyes with eye salve that thou mayest see.
That thou mayest see. Here go. Psalms 119, verse 18. Psalms 119, verse 18.
Psalms 119, verse 18. Open thou mine eyes.
Open thou mine eyes. Go ahead.
That I may behold wondrous things out of thy law.
That's what we want the Lord to do. Open our eyes so that we can behold wondrous things out of your law. Watch this. Give me Ephesians 1:18. Ephesians 1:18. So we want the Lord to open our eyes. And that's what has happened from the time that Elijah came back on the earth. Elijah came, taught the gospel, and began to open brothers and sisters' eyes. So who they are, what this Bible says we are. That's what we're doing today. We're keeping this legacy going till the second coming of Christ. Read.
Ephesians chapter 1, verse 18. The eyes of your understanding being enlightened.
The eyes of your understanding being enlightened. Go ahead.
That ye may know what is the hope of his calling.
That you may know what is the hope of his calling. Was that it?
And what the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints.
Read it again.
The eyes of your understanding being enlightened.
So that's what we want. The eyes of our understanding being enlightened. That goes back to what we just read about being illuminated. being illuminated. Psalms 111:10, please. How do we get our eyes opened? How do we get the understanding? Psalms 111:10, basic scripture, basic principle.
Psalms chapter 111, verse 10. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom.
The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. We got to fear God first, right?
A good understanding.
A good understanding hath
all they that do his commandments.
The word do is a verb. The word do is a verb, not a noun. Do is an action word. So you can't just talk about it. You got to be about it. Everybody understand that? Give me Psalms 119:27.
Psalms 119:27. Make me to understand the way of thy precepts.
Uh-huh.
So shall I talk of thy wondrous works.
Make me to understand the way of thy precepts. So shall I talk of thy wondrous works. This is why when we sit around, brothers, listen good. Our conversation got to change. Many times, brothers want to sit around and talk. Remember what happened at, not the old school, the last school. With boxing. Remember what happened? Brothers in there talking about boxing. Who's going to win? I forgot. Do you remember who was fighting? Who was boxing? I forgot. It was back at House of David with a mafia. I'm going way back. And it was almost a fist fight in the school. We had to take the TV out. It was a mess. Because brothers arguing about who was the better fighter. I forgot who was talking. Who was fighting? I forgot. But in this truth, brothers, when it says, so shall I talk of thy wondrous works, our conversation got to change. We got to start to make our thoughts in conversation about the word of God. If we talk about a movie, guess what? If we ever go to movies and we come out of that movie and talk about it, guess what we always do? We will filter it and reflect it and relate it to something in the Bible. That's what we do. That's the transforming of your conversation. Because sometimes in your mind, it gets boring talking about that Bible. I get bored. I could talk about it maybe 5 minutes, but an hour talking about the Bible? Yeah, I could talk about it for more than I could talk about it all day. And if I see something to happen, I'm going to relate something to the... That's you disciplining your thoughts. That's what a leader does. That's what you men got to do. Discipline your thoughts. What are you going to say, Elsa?
You know, you just said something heavy there because that is... Some people really think about that. How could you brothers teach that Bible all day? Like y'all see me like in the morning class, I'll teach 4 or 5 hours. Brothers be like, "Bag man, don't you get tired? Don't get tired of this."
A Negro don't get tired of sports. Does a Negro get tired of talking about sports?
No.
They know Pete brother. They know stats on people, dates of birth, weight, height, everything. Brothers know. They know his heart. They know his mama.
They know his daddy's shoe size. Than their own life.
Yeah, they know everything, but when it comes to this Bible, and this is our records, our book. Give me that. So, stay in the same chapter. Give me verse 34.
You know something, Bishop? I just dwelled on that thing about the sports. You know, when I go to work, and we got a locker room and all that, and I'm sitting in there, and they talking to me. They want to engage me in the conversation and think I'm going to even pay attention to it. And they come in, "Yo, so-and-so, the stats of this and that." And I'm looking at them like, "Nigga, what the hell is wrong with you?" And I can't even fathom to even get anywhere close to that kind of conversation. Mm-hmm. And I mean, they be all in it. Newspapers, the TV on it.
Yeah, they be talking. They be talking about football. And they say, "Hey, you saw the game?" I said, "Yeah, Red Sox." What?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I do that too.
They look at Red Sox.
I do that. I love doing
that's
that.
That's to mess with them.
I do that.
It's stupid conversation.
I said, "Throw the football through the basketball goal," something like that.
Yeah. Basketball hoop.
Yeah. The basketball. Well, the hoop, something. Yeah. Something like. Something like that. You know.
Read that for me, Officer Leon.
Verse 34. Give me understanding, and I shall keep thy law. Yea, I shall observe it with my whole heart.
That's what understanding does. Stay in the same book. Jump down to verse 73.
Verse 73. Thy hands have made me and fashioned me. Give me understanding that I may learn thy commandments.
So just as David is saying here, this is what we want. We want the Lord to give us understanding so that we can keep his commandments. That's what we want. Watch this. Look at Luke 24 and 25. I'm going to show you something. I'm going to show y'all that the conversation of the Bible and what it did to the men, the disciples of Christ.
Luke 24, verse 45. Then opened he their
understanding. What verse you at?
Verse 45.
No, 25.
25. Then he said unto them, O fools, and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken.
So, Christ had just resurrected. These disciples thought that Christ had not resurrected. So now Christ is walking with them. They don't recognize it's him. And he gets on them, calling them fools, because they did not believe all that the prophets said about Christ's resurrection. Read it again.
Then he said unto them, O fools, and slow of heart, to believe all.
When it says slow of heart, means slow of mind. Go ahead.
To believe all that the prophets have spoken. Ought not Christ to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory? And the beginning at Moses.
And not the beginning. It says and beginning.
And beginning at Moses. And all the prophets, he expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself.
Go ahead.
And they drew nigh unto the village whither they went. And he made as though he would have gone further. But they constrained him, saying, Abide with us, for it is toward evening, and the day is far spent. And he went in to tarry with them. And it came to pass, as he had sat at meat with them, he took bread and blessed it and brake and gave to them. And their eyes were opened. And they knew him.
That's when they recognized this is Christ. Go ahead.
And he vanished out of their sight.
Uh-huh.
And they said one to another.
Listen good to what they say.
Did not our heart burn within us while he talked with us by the way and while he opened to us the scriptures?
You see that? It said, did not our hearts burn within us? That means you got such excitement about talking about this, you can hear about it all day. You see, just like some of you brothers about sports, you could talk about that garbage all day. Our forefathers talked about the scriptures, and it said their hearts burned within them. Then it says, while he opened to us the scriptures. When it says that he opened to us the scriptures, he explained the scriptures. Give me that precept for that in Nehemiah about 8:8, gave the sense,
right.
That one. This is what it means. It says that Christ opened to them the scriptures. Nehemiah 8:8, is it?
Nehemiah chapter 8, verse 8.
This is what it means when it says he opened to them the scriptures.
So they read in the book in the law of God distinctly.
Distinctly.
And gave the sense.
Gave the sense.
And caused them to understand the reading.
And caused them to understand the reading. That's what Christ did with those disciples he was walking with. Was that it?
That's it.
So now when we go back. In order for you, see, this is why the white man want to stop this truth. Because brothers, sisters, let me tell you something. Once you hear the proper understanding of the scriptures, you ain't going to forget it. It's going to be there in your mind, in your spirit.
You got to repeat that again.
I forgot what I said.
You know, once you get the proper understanding of the Bible, that's it. That is it. Once you get the proper, it's just like we said about Esau. We take chapters and verses from him.
Right.
Once we break down Obadiah correctly, he can never touch that part of the Bible again.
Exactly.
Because every time he look at it, he going to remember what he heard.
That's right. Yeah. Isaiah 14 about
exactly.
Lucifer too.
Exactly. Once you break all that.
Deuteronomy 28. For years, centuries, Esau would break down Deuteronomy 28 as if it meant nothing.
Right.
Now when the servants of God came on the earth and said, no, this is what, here's the sense, here's the understanding. Now all things have changed now. Now Esau's upset and angry. And he want to do videos to try to stop this thing. Mr. White Man, you ain't stopping this. Understand that.
The only thing going to stop is your heart. Your heart going to stop.
Exactly. Our captivity is almost up. Go back to Luke
24, verse 32.
I'll jump down to verse 44 and 45.
Verse 44. And he said unto them, these are the words.
This is Christ speaking.
These are the words which I spake unto you while I was yet with you, that all things must be fulfilled, which were written in the law of Moses, and in the prophets, and in the Psalms concerning me.
So that's what he was breaking down for the apostles, the disciples, I mean. Go ahead.
Then open he their understanding.
See that part? Then open he their understanding. Go ahead.
That they might understand the scriptures.
That means he gave them the sense. He gave them, what was the other words in that, Nehemiah 8? He gave them the sense and caused them to understand the reading. That's what he was doing. Guess what, brothers? Says that's what our job is. When you brothers hit the streets, that's what your job is. You're in Christ's position to do that. Okay? Yes.
Right. That's what the elders used to tell us at the old school. He said, our job is to make the Bible real to the people. Mm-hmm. That's the point, given the sense. It's no longer just words in a book. You have to take the Bible and apply it to the people's condition. Right. When they begin to see themselves in the book, that's when it becomes relevant. That's when you've caused the people to understand the reading, because they can identify with it. That's the reason why I use the term, or we use the term, this is your photo album. Once you understand that this is about you, your personal business, then it has a connection. That's when the sense is made.
Exactly. Give me Acts chapter 8. Acts chapter 8, verse 30 and 31.
Like reading your mail, right? Acts chapter 8, verse 30. And Philip ran hither to him and heard him read the prophet Isaiah.
Jump up to 27, because people, Christians get stupid on this too. Watch.
And he arose, verse 27, and he arose and went, and behold, a man of Ethiopia, an eunuch of great authority under Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, who had the charge of all her treasure. And he had come to Jerusalem for to worship.
People, Christians get stupid and say, see, all nations could come into this, not just Israelites. The Ethiopian is Israel. Give me that in Zephaniah 3. You know, I always get the Z's mixed up. Verse 10. 3 and 10 is about Ethiopia.
Zephaniah chapter 3, verse 10. From beyond the rivers of Ethiopia.
From beyond the rivers of Ethiopia. That's in Africa. Come on.
My suppliants.
My suppliants.
My suppliants. Even the daughter of my dispersed.
See that? Even the daughter of my dispersed. Dispersed. What does that mean, dispersed? Scattered Israelites. Read.
Shall bring mine offering. And that day shalt thou be not ashamed for all thy doings, wherein thou hast transgressed against me. For then I will take away out of the midst of them that rejoice in thy pride, and thou shalt no more be haughty because of my holy mountain. I will also leave in the midst of thee an afflicted and poor people, and they shall trust in the name of the Lord. The remnant of Israel.
That's who the dispersed are. He's making it plain for you. The remnant of Israel. So stop saying there's no Israelites over in Africa. Stop with that stupidity. The Bible's prophesying they're there. Go ahead.
The remnant of Israel shall not do iniquity, nor speak lies, neither shall a deceitful tongue be found in their mouth.
Now go to Isaiah 11:11. People get dumb. Never let these Christians with their evil philosophy, their bloody religion.
Isaiah 11:11. And it shall come to pass in that day that the Lord shall set his hand again the second time to recover the remnant of his people, which shall be left from Assyria and from Egypt and from Pathros and from Cush.
These are the lands of our captivity then and now. Because the slave trade was big. Sub-Saharan slave trade as well as the transatlantic slave trade was vast and broad. It was the largest and worst holocaust of the earth. Read.
And from Elam and from Shinar and from Hamath and from the islands of the sea. And he shall set up an ensign for the nations and shall assemble the outcasts of Israel.
So the outcasts of Israel were scattered as slaves in all those lands. That's what this gospel is about. The gospel is about Jesus Christ dying on the cross, redeeming us back to the Father, and us being gathered together as the nation of Israel. That's the good news. We have a chance now to inherit this kingdom on earth. That's what the good news is. Not that your enemy, the devil, white man that raped your mother, he's going to get the kingdom too. That's not the good news. What's good about that? You raped my mama. What the hell is wrong with you? Black people are sick. We are sick people.
Hey, you know what lends to that sickness? That class that was done with Deegan Athun about the Stockholm Syndrome and traumatic bonding. That's a heavy statement. That's a heavy word. You got to look that word. You bond with your enemy because of the trauma caused you to fall in love with your abusers.
Give me one scripture. How many teach on it? How many of you, raise your hand, who teach on the streets? All right, keep it. Give me one scripture that talks about Stockholm Syndrome. I want one scripture only. Stockholm Syndrome, feelings of trust or affection felt in certain cases of kidnapping or hostage taking by a victim toward a captive. Meaning you love your master. Let me hear that brother right there on my left. Yeah.
Shalom, leadership.
Shalom.
Baruch.
What's your name?
Benaya.
Benaya. Where you from?
Jamaica.
Okay.
Baruch 4, verse 3.
No. No, I'm doing a Yahusab. Let me just give it to you. Okay, Reuben, I'll give you one more. Reuben.
Rack your brain.
It's gonna, Isaiah 30, verse 12.
No. Okay, one more chance, Ezekiel. What? This is it. If you don't get it, then that's it.
Isaiah 28:15.
No, have a seat. Here we go. Strong and wrong. Go to 2 Maccabees. Y'all know my eyes is bad. 2 Maccabees chapter 4. Verse 15 and 16. We're going to get to the point. This, y'all write this down. This is Stockholm Syndrome. To the utmost.
2 Maccabees chapter 4, verse 15. Not setting by the honors of their fathers, but liking the glory of the Grecians best of all. By reason whereof, so calamity came upon them.
No. I'm sorry. Read 15 again. 15 one more time.
Not setting by the honors of their fathers.
The honors of our fathers is how our fathers were in the scriptures. Who our fathers were, how they looked, how they described in the scriptures. That's the honor of our fathers. The laws, the commandments, all the encompasses the entire thing. Go ahead.
But liking the glory of the Grecians best of all.
We enjoyed the glory of the Grecians more, or the Romans more, or American white man more, British more, the French more, the Dutch more. We admire them more than our own forefathers. Rather than, for example, you mentioned it earlier, our people know more stats on these Olympian players than their own forefathers in the scriptures, than the precepts. They know their age, their toe, their feet, foot size, madness, but don't know the scriptures. Go ahead.
By reason whereof sore calamity came upon them, for they had them to be their enemies and avengers.
So the Most High sent this nation against us for chastisement, the avengers and enemies, go ahead.
Whose custom they followed so earnestly.
We ended up loving our oppressor. That's Stockholm Syndrome right there. So earnestly, meaning in every detail. How, for example, today, the new style is the rock star style. The rock star style is the mohawk with the blonding of the hair on the top. The skinny tight pants, the bleaching of the skin, the bleaching of the hair. That's all liking the glory of the Grecians best of all. That's all it boils down to. The piercing on their face, they're piercing their eyes, their ears, their scalp. It's retarded, full retard stuff. I'm seeing. That's loving the glory of the Grecians most of all. Go ahead.
And unto whom they desire to be like in all things.
In every way. Speak like them, dress like them, yeah. Act like them, sleep with them, marry them, live among them. Stockholm Syndrome. That's the Negro today.
Exactly. I hope you understand that. I hope y'all wrote that down. It'll be good on the street. Good on the street. Now, go back to Acts 8 and 30 because we didn't finish that in Acts 8 and 30.
Acts 8, verse 30. And Philip ran thither to him and heard him read the prophet Isaiah.
So this is the Ethiopian brother, the Israelite from Ethiopia. Go ahead.
And said, understandest thou what thou readest?
He said, do you understand what you're reading in that Bible? Remember this. A lot of our people read the Bible on the train, on the bus, at home, in church. Go ahead.
And he said, how can I except some man should guide me.
None of them want to admit this part. How can you understand the Bible except some man should guide me? The only one who can give you the understanding is Christ, the Spirit of Christ. It has to be the, like, this is why, listen good to what I'm about to say. I'm about to say something you don't understand. Read that part again.
And he said, how can I except some man should guide me? And he desired Philip that he would come up and sit with him.
So our Ethiopian brother understood a basic principle. I cannot understand the Bible except some man should guide me. He didn't have the spirit of pride. Could you ask our people today? They all said they understand the Bible. I understand it. They don't understand nothing. Nothing. It has to be a man who has had the spirit of the Lord upon him. I'm going to go back in history now. We read earlier about Christ opened the understanding of the of our brothers. You read about Nehemiah, how the Levitical priests opened the understanding to our brothers. Watch this. Malachi 3 and 4. Malachi 3 and 4. You're not going to get the understanding on your own. And when you hear brothers say, I learned this on my own, that's a lie. What? Read that. You know, am I calling it right? Malachi 3 and 4?
3 and 4.
Elijah, I want.
Oh, Malachi 4, verse 5.
Thank you.
Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before.
This is the prophecy. Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet. Go ahead.
Before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord.
That's talking about the day of the Lord, the second coming of Christ. So the prophecy is the Lord will send Elijah the prophet to come back. And what would he do?
And he shall turn the heart of the fathers.
The hearts of our fathers is this Bible. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Moses, David, Christ, Solomon, Paul, Peter, James, John.
And he shall turn the heart of the fathers to the children.
We're the children, meaning the children of Israel. That's who we are. Go ahead.
And the heart of the children.
The heart of the children of Israel, meaning our minds.
To their fathers.
To our fathers. Our fathers, to Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Moses, Solomon, Christ, David. So except that it happened, we would all still be running around in Baptist religion, Pentecostal religion, Catholic religion, voodoo, Eligua, Shango. But this proves Elijah has come and gone. Now we know who we are and whose we be.
Exactly. I'm gonna give you some personal history of the proof of what we just read. My mother and father are voracious Bible readers. Bible readers. Grew up in the house. Bible was read, quoted almost every day. They knew nothing about the Bible. When I came into this truth, I realized that they didn't know nothing about the Bible. Nothing. Absolutely nothing. Could quote every scripture like us. There's some videos when I talked about how I came into this truth. When I learned about certain things, I went and asked him about it. He said, yeah, I know what that is. I know about this. I know about it. I'm like, what the hell? You know all of this and you don't know that you're Israel? Don't know nothing about the Bible. So my point is, it is until I came up on the men that knew this Bible, that's when it began to have new eyes to open my understanding up. That's my point. And I'm talking about they knew nothing about the Bible and could quote it from Genesis to Revelation.
Bishop. Read that scripture again.
And he shall turn the heart of the father to the children, and the heart of the children to their fathers.
You know what? They're very important. The heart of the children to their father. Who heart we have today? Who heart we have today? The right man. Philosophy, whatever he taught us, that's what we have in our mind. Our mind have to transform to be like our forefather, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob mind. You understand? But our mind we have today, before the truth come, we have the mind of the white man. Cannot wait to have a master degree or a PhD to live next to white folks up the hill. That was your whole thing. You will murder your own people to live up the hill. You will kill your own brothers, your own sister to live up the hill. That was your whole mindset. The murder might upset.
So Elijah has come and gone. And what Elijah did, he taught us not only who we are, he taught us to teach with all authority. Give me that in Jeremiah 1:18. I'm going to show y'all something. What I'm going to show you is going to show you the difference between I'll say it in a minute, but go ahead. Don't let me forget my thought.
Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 18. For behold, I have made thee this day a defense city and an iron pillar.
Read the verse above it, I'm sorry.
Verse 17. Thou therefore gird up thy loins and arise and speak unto them all that I commanded thee.
Notice it says, teach them all that I command thee. Meaning what this Bible says, teach it. Go ahead.
Be not dismayed at their faces.
When it says be not dismayed at their faces, where do you think the servants of God would be, brothers? In the streets. Not hiding behind a computer. Read.
Lest I confound thee.
He says, if you're afraid of their face, I will confound you. Go ahead.
Before them.
Before them. Was that it?
That's it.
So now, Titus 2:15. So when Elijah came, because we tell you the stories of the brother whom we can't prove it, but we do believe it was Elijah. Because he was the only one that taught about the two kingdoms during that time period in the 60s. Okay? Read that, Titus 2:15.
Titus 2, verse 15. These things speak and exhort and rebuke with all authority.
You see that? Rebuke with all authority. You're going to see a difference between those that came through the schools that Elijah, who we believe was Abba Bivens, set up, and all the other Israelites. You'll see the stark difference in their boldness. You'll see the difference in their understanding of scriptures. Okay? Everybody understand what I'm saying? Because you got Israelites, like in Chicago, the Israel of God, they don't hit the streets. They go, yeah, bro, you know, the scriptures say that we Israel, you know. What? We Israel, you know. The spirit of boldness is not there. The power and authority is not there. The understanding of basic concepts is not there. They're missing a whole, like even with the Northern Kingdom. A lot of them didn't know that. About the Puerto Ricans, the Dominicans, the Mexicans. Who, what? No, they're not. Yeah, they are Israel. Here's the proof. Bam! Now, the 12 tribes show us. Shut up. So the only ones that's going to have this understanding, like when you read from the time of Christ, when they anointed the people, those who were under Christ and all that, those who got anointed, that spirit remained on them. That's the ones you see from the time of Bivens.
Right.
The elders that anointed them. That's why we do that here. So when brothers go out to these different places, that same spirit that they get from us is on them.
Exactly.
And they carry it on. That's what the 144 is going to do. Exactly. You ain't going to go back into the world talk about like that new thing that the Judas Iscariot twin says, Jesus didn't look like Raheem.
Yes.
He might have been Arab or something like this. Are you kidding me?
I ain't paying that no.
They try to discredit his color.
That thing, no business at all, man.
There's three things now. They're trying to discredit the image of Christ. They have a problem with the image that we brought to life. They hate the 12 tribes sign now. Y'all see that? A lot of people now are attacking the 12 tribes. And a lot of people are trying to push now in a large scale that Ephraim has nothing, the Northern Kingdom has nothing to do with the Israelites. I'm not going to sit down and convince those people. I'm going to dismiss them. Okay, because the Most High decided to leave you on that level. So I'm not going to bring you, I'm not going to elevate you because you won't humble yourself. If you humble yourself, you can figure these things out. Now, an easy argument for the 12 tribes sign. If you get the 12 tribes chart and you look at all those people there, what they're arguing is that they're not in the regions where they're supposed to be today. Or there's a whole bunch of the people on the sign in the same region. One of the arguments was, all these people can be in the West Indies. It's not my job to explain to you where the West Indies is. My job is to explain to you that the people on the 12 tribes sign fit the curses in the Bible. That's it. I don't have to explain to you everything there. Do these people, it says that these curses shall be upon thee for a sign and for a wonder. Did all the people on this sign go have the same enemy, go through the same curse, go into captivity? But there's people who want you to be geography experts to try and explain these things to them. That's wickedness. That's evil.
Right. They don't believe Asaph. Them people like that, they really don't believe at all.
They don't believe. That's what I'm getting. When you were speaking about teach the Bible in all authority and boldness, that's the spirit that I'm coming from. When we were taught by bold men. That's how we learned the Bible under bold men. that taught the Bible with all authority. That was my first encounter with Israel. When I saw them brothers speak out there in the street the way they were speaking, I said, this right here ain't no punk stuff. This is the real deal here. I knew that the minute I saw it. And those are the kind of men we learned under. So when I see this weak garbage that you talk about, ASAP, with these, do these guys don't mean nothing to me?
You got these.
You understand? We come up under the boldness of how we were taught this Bible. That's how we roll it. And that's how you got to roll. That's right. That's how you have to be.
Shalom, Israel. I'm Elder Nathaniel of Israel United in Christ. YouTube likes to shut our channels down, as some of you have noticed, ever so often. Subscribing to Join IUIC will assure you will always stay connected to our YouTube accounts. We want to do our best to make sure this truth gets out. Please click and join our subscriber YouTube channel called Join IUIC to stay linked to all of our videos. So again, please make sure you subscribe to this Join IUIC channel to get your latest updates on all our YouTube channels. Shalom.